Lent, a season of reflection, re-evaluation, new beginnings, a time to recognize God's grace in our lives, to find ways to let that realization sink in and take root, drawing closer to God as we are changed by His love. In this season, we should give of ourselves, our time, money, possessions. Giving helps us to see better the needs of those around us. It brings to light those things that may have too high a priority in our lives. It helps us to separate what we need from what we want, stripping away the things that keep us separated from one another and God. We should fast. It helps us to be reminded of the need for God to fill us, whether food or social media, your phone or computer. Fasting allows us to physically feel the ongoing spiritual needs of the soul. It helps us to see the truth that only God can truly satisfy. We should pray. It slows us down, focuses us on God. It enables us to be pulled away from our grip on the world and everything we think it can give us, and moves us closer to seeing God in the midst of it all. God is inviting us into this holy season, wanting us to be free from all the obstacles that keep us from His fullness. May we allow ourselves to be stripped down and cleansed, so that we may come to understand more powerfully the love of God and be made new in His righteousness and alive in His grace.
Well, I'm Juno, and thank you for joining us as we continue to dive into this subject of a simple life. But before I get started, I want to congratulate somebody here. Let me first explain. Now, in the Reformed Church, we have several steps required and numerous criteria to be met if somebody wants to be a pastor in a church. We don't just give the title away as if it were candy or as a little carrot and here, do this, do that, and we'll call you a pastor. But it really is a process. And the RCA has a commissioned pastor role, and it's a process which is given to the people who have been approved by their board, who have completed their studies, who knows the RCA polity, our form of government, understands their call to service, and has the ability to teach. This accomplishment really gives our classes, which is the local governing board of us, gives our classes the assurance that those who have passed these requirements for a commissioned pastor are indeed ready to pastor and lead the church. So in addition to completing her master's degree in theology and ministry, her experience in ministry and life, and meeting all of the criteria and then some of our classes, I'd like to congratulate Rachel for becoming a commissioned pastor. Rachel, why don't you come up here, please? Mark, we'll let you come up too. And also the current board, can you come up here? We're going to pray for Rachel as she brings her gifts to us here at New Life. Now again, with this move or with this acknowledgement, Rachel can now be officially called a pastor. So we can't call her Pastor Loman because we won't know who we're talking to. And my guess is she really doesn't want you to always address her as Pastor Rachel. But again, she does have that title and she has earned it very well. And so Brenda's going to pray first on our board. Mark will pray and then I'll wrap it up.
Okay, let us pray.
And for those of you who are comfortable, and even if you're uncomfortable with it, feel free to extend your hand as a way of being a part of this prayer and giving God's grace. Amen. To Rachel.
Amen. Father in heaven, we praise your awesome name and the glory of your wonderful Son, Jesus, we are humbled that you have granted yet another of your children the opportunity, the diligent opportunity to be about the work of your love and your ordination, Father. We thank you for Rachel Lohman, Lord, as she now passed the commissioned exams to be the pastor of us, Lord. We just thank you that you've given her this opportunity, Father. We ask you to give her a strong love, a love that Jesus has for the community, Father. We ask you to keep her focused and to know that you are her refuge and her defense, trusting in you at all times. Lord, we pray for uplifting of Rachel's family, her husband, her church family, Lord, that we can be a stepping stone for her and a foundation for her, Father. We just ask you, Lord, to touch her heart and fill her, Lord, with all the glory that you have for your children. We ask you, Lord, to remind Rachel that you are the one true and living God, and as she presents herself to the public, Father, that she become just what you need for her to be in this new life for the city, Lord. We love you, Lord, and we thank you, and we just bless the families that are represented here in this church, Father. We bless our pastors, and we just love you, Lord. And we say these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
God, we just come before you with so much thanks. May we be first the people that are thankful. And so we are just so thankful for Rachel, for just the unique way that you've made her, for the opportunities before her, before us as a church. And so we are just so thankful for her as a pastor, for the gifts you've given her, for the passions you've given her. Lord, may you release her even more so with those gifts and with those passions. May she just fly like a bird with its wings unclipped. And Lord, as someone who does the same task, Lord, I just pray that Rachel remembers that her identity is in you and in not in what she does. Lord, that she is loved by you, that she finds her status in you, not how other people encourage her or criticize her. So Lord, we just pray a shield of protection over her. We just pray against the evil one. We pray, Lord, that she puts on the armor of God and that she fights for your kingdom. Protect her. Lord, I selfishly pray for our marriage, that you would protect our marriage. I pray, Lord, that our marriage would be the loudest gospel witness of your love for the church. And so, Lord, allow Rachel to equip this church to be the hands and feet of your kingdom. She's an equipper. She's a leader. Her job is not to do the ministry, but is to encourage and equip other people in here to do your ministry, expanding your kingdom in Artesia and Cerritos and beyond. So, Lord, just continue to work in her. We're so thankful for her. Amen.
Lord God, for Rachel, again, we give you thanks. For her gifting and her history in life, she brings all of that to us, to serve us as your people, to lead us as your people, so that we can make a difference for your kingdom. And so I thank you. And I do also, as Mark prayed, I pray for them as a couple in ministry, that you will help them to create balance, that you'll help them to say yes to the things they need to and no to the things they need to. I pray that you'll protect her heart from the darts that people may throw at times. Lord, we work with people you've created, people who are human, and yet people who at times say some hurtful and mean things. And so I just pray that you will make her heart strong enough, that you will protect her and shield her from those comments, while also giving her the vigor she needs to step forward as you have created her. And so again, Lord, we are grateful that she is a part of our family and now a part of our team as we are new life for the city. In your name I pray, amen. So again, Rachel, welcome. So again, we are continuing in this series, A Simple Life Through Lent. And we've talked about the importance of silence and solitude. And last week, I talked and shared about the importance of fasting and how we read in Scripture that from our Lord that fasting really isn't an option, but that it is a normal and it is an expected practice as followers of Jesus. And we also talked about that these disciplines, that these holy habits are not done to earn more of God's love, but rather they are these rhythms of life, these routines that we get into help us to really love God even more as our Creator. And so through Lent, there are really these three pillars that we talk about. And they're traditionally known as fasting, giving, and prayer. And while these, and the question that I even ask is, well, why these? And understand that these are traditions that many churches across the country, Reformed and not Reformed and everything else, that they lean into during this season, those ideas of fasting, giving, and prayer. And really why? It's because that's what Jesus did. He modeled a lifestyle of giving. He prayed. And so traditionally during this season, we intentionally focus on the same behaviors of Jesus. And so as today, we're going to focus on giving. And so let me ask you, don't turn off your heart right now. Don't turn off your mind, because I know that for some people, giving and the subject of money is a very sensitive issue for them. But I don't want you to be thinking again that, well, here it comes again. The church is asking for money. And just be in a place where you can be receptive. Receptive to be hearing what God has to say about this subject of giving. And so as we, for me even to step into that idea and to talk about giving, I'm going to need to briefly address the subject of money for just a few moments. Now, for those of you who are going through the Rooted study, a little of this will be a repeat, but that was 2 weeks ago, and my guess is you may have forgotten it by now. So we'll listen to some of this again. Despite our feelings of often thinking, oh, that's all the church talks about, or here he comes again, or here is another message or some hints about this idea with money, let us remember that Jesus also talked a lot about money. There are over 500 references to prayer in Scripture. There are less than 500 on the subject of faith. And there are over 2,000 references to the idea of giving, to the idea of thinking of others, to the idea of living lives of generosity, to the ideas of not being controlled by money. So Jesus was aware of the pull of money even as he walked this earth into the hearts of the people he created. And so it's important for us that we remember as I talk about money, that verse that many of us know, 1 Timothy 6:10, that for the love of money is a root for all kinds of evil. And it's the love of money. It isn't money that is bad. It is the love of money. And so if money consumes us, if money is the only thing that we are desiring, that's our top goal in life, then Houston, we have a problem. And I think many of us know that, but it's still at times that uncomfortable topic in the church today. And also, let's remember, we know people who are over the top wealthy. And they, all they think about is money. And then we also know people who are at the opposite end of the income level. Many of us would say poorer than poor. And they also have a focus that they are just centered in on money. So again, it isn't that you have a little that makes you holy, and it isn't that you have a lot that makes you sinful. It's whether or not it is where your heart is at. Because we know throughout Scripture, money has been used to do very wonderful things for the kingdom. And we know even here in our own reality that God uses money to help spread his grace and his love to many people. And so again, Jesus equates the desire for money in the same sentence as he talks about God. And again, people, the reality is that Jesus knew when he walked on this earth that there is going to be a battle for our hearts. And the battle he is talking about is the battle for money. Let's take a look at Matthew 6, 24. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. So this is not a new subject. It was around since Jesus walked on this earth that he was even telling his people, you know, you can't serve both. If money is your God, then the God of creation isn't your God. He isn't your Lord of everything. And he just cautioned his people. And so again today, it is a word of caution on the potential destruction that the love of money can do for us. And so today we continue to lean into this, remembering what Jesus was warning his followers about. That if we allow money to take root in our heart, it will eventually destroy us. It destroys marriages. It derails cultures. It messes up careers. It is one of the elements that destroys many marriages. It causes meltdowns, even the best people in the world, because somehow, some way, they got off focus and money became their God. And so it's just a reminder. This is just a good reminder for us people to know that, again, that it's a slippery slope, so to speak. It's, you know, we need money to pay our bills, to live, and to buy the food, to buy the clothing, to go to school, to take vacations. So none of those things are wrong. None of those things are evil. Except, again, you are the one. What's important here, again, you are the one to decide, is my concern and my desire for money kicking God out of my heart and taking rest in who I am? And so this isn't a time to be elbowing the person next to you, especially if you don't know them. That could be kind of weird. But it's really to do a self-evaluation during this Lenten season on what priority are you giving God and what priority are you giving to money. Helping the needy is also a part of the idea of giving money. And so what I want to do here is let's take a look. I'm going to read you a part of Matthew. It's not going to be on the screen. It's from a different version. And I think some of us are used to hearing the word alms, A-L-M-S. Rachel, can you bring me that water, please? Give the alms to the poor, give to the poor. And we've seen it in movies, and that is just a word that has been used, and depends on what portion of what translation of scripture that you have, but it will say the word alms in lieu of giving. But let me read that to you. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you, this is Matthew 6, 2 through 4, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. When you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret. And your Father who sees you, it sees in secret will reward you. So that's a different version, and in King James, I tried to read that this week, and it was such a tongue twister, I did not read it for you. So let me read it for you in the version that you have in the chair in front of you, and that would be on page 678. It is Matthew 6, 2 through 4. I'm going to read it to you in another translation, and they use, and you'll see the difference. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be done in secret. Then the Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. So again, the version you have may use the word alms, and you may be familiar with that through your own tradition. But really, again, the giving of alms is really, what it really means is giving to the needy. And it tells us, don't get caught up with announcing it, making sure everybody knows what you're doing. It's really a heart thing, which sort of goes back to you can't serve both God and money. It really goes back to your heart. Again, we read here, so when you give to the needy, giving to the needy is not an option. So when you give to the needy, so we need to be giving to the needy. It's not a suggestion. It is really a directive. It is assumed to be a part of the lifestyle of those who follow Jesus. And as in many aspects of the life of those who follow, a believer, a disciple who follow Jesus, it's easier said than done. Let's just admit it. It's a whole lot easier to say it than it is to do it. And yet, could it be that helping the needy is another way that Jesus is giving us a hint, that Jesus is telling us that as you give to the needy, your heart is changed, your heart is opened, and that the mystery of the gospel is taking place in your own life as you give it away? Now, that doesn't say you can't have a savings. It doesn't say you can't retire. So I want to address those things so people aren't going to one extreme to the next. It's not saying that I have to give my rent money this month to other people, and then I'm out of my rent money, and then I'm evicted, and then some of you are going to take me in. You know, it's not saying that. It is saying I need to be able to give to the needy. I just found it interesting as I kept reading this over and over and trying to figure out, God, how does this relate to us here in Artesia, this idea of giving to the needy? And so as it is a part of that gift of mercy, some people have that gift of mercy. I mean, they're giving everything they own away. They're helping clothe people, feed people, give drinks, so thank you, Rachel, for showing the gift of mercy to me. I don't need to be poor to receive the gift of mercy. And so there are people that are not destitute that need the gift of mercy. And maybe God has placed you in their life for that reason. So during this season of Lent, again, it's a time of intentionally trying to convert our hearts and changing the way we live so that we can be live like Jesus. And so it is a time, again, to examine how we deal with those in need. That's a pretty heavy question that will probably take our lifetime to answer. But I found it, let's also be realistic. As Jesus walked the earth, he healed many people. He fed thousands of people. And yet there are still those who weren't healed. There are still those who were hungry. And so while we may not be able to eradicate the problem of need or the problem of hunger, we can extend an alm to somebody. And so how do we do that? And so again, as we look through that, I'm thinking, well, I've been working on my taxes this weekend. I know they probably should have been done, but they're not. I'm still 2 weeks ahead of the game. So, but as I'm working on my taxes, it's like, hey, I pay a boatload of money in taxes. That is a way of giving to the needy. When we give our assessments to the Reformed Church of America, and they help guide us, well, part of that is helping the needy. When you give your offerings to the church, part of that is helping the needy. But for some reason, that still seems like it's, while it technically is, I don't think that's the direction God wants our heart to go, to simply say, I gave at the office. I gave through my taxes. Because what that does is that really creates almost a barrier. It creates a we versus them, the haves and the have-nots. And so by giving alms, by giving to the needy, walls are broken down. And we start to realize that we are all God's people. But still, how do we deal with that in 2017? In very practical ways. Well, again, as with fasting last week, I shared, if we don't have a plan, we just go hungry and are frustrated and angry. And I think the same with giving. If we don't have a plan, I think we will often feel guilty or resentful for the things, whether it's money, our time, sharing our material possessions that we give away, because God is not, again, working his mysterious and wondrous work in our heart. And so many, many Christians look to the idea of tithing as their plan. A tithing is 10% of your income to the church. It's an Old Testament practice, and throughout history, many believers have used that as their plan. They get that again from Malachi. Malachi 3:10, so let me read that for you here. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room to store it. And so again, tithing, giving 10%, is one way to plan, to make a plan to give, because otherwise, I can use all that money myself, to be honest with you. A couple weeks ago, I was checking through my records. And, you know, you can go online and you can check your giving to the church. And so I did. And I realized I missed a week of giving my tithe. And it's like, gosh. And so I called Kristen, or I sent an email. I think I thought I gave. I'm pretty sure I give, but it's not in my record. And yeah, reality is, nope, for some reason I just forgot. Now, some would say that's why we have the automatic giving. You can give your bank and make that withdrawal and et cetera, but I'm still on some things old-fashioned. I give a check. And sure enough, I had to double up with my next paycheck. And it's just like, okay, I thought I had a little extra spending money this month, but I guess not. And so a plan helps to avoid that. And there wasn't anything evil about me. I wasn't trying to rip off God. I wasn't going to try to buy a new car, and so I needed a few extra $100 to make that down payment happen. Nope. It's sort of like life, and for whatever reason, I forgot to give. And so maybe this Lenten season, for some of you, and you know who you are, if you can give 10%, but you're like me, absent-minded in some things, you know, maybe you just need to have it withdrawn. If you're not, and I'm used to tithing, but if you're not used to it, folks, it's not going to be easy. You're going to be in shock when that 10% is withdrawn from your account, or if you give it. You're going to feel the pain of that money leaving, whether it's $20 or whether it's $200 or $400 or $500. But after the third or fourth time, it becomes a little easier and you learn to live on the 90% also that God has blessed you with. Yep, that may mean you use that budget word. It may mean for some people that you can't buy three or four $4 cups of coffee a week. It may mean that you postpone a vacation because you really want to give God first out of a heart of thanksgiving and to know and to trust God that he'll meet your needs. I don't know how it works, but it does. Again, I'm going to go back to, I think it's one of the mysteries of the faith that God will meet your needs as you give back to him. And so again, I know for some of you that's going to be impossible. So I'm not up here saying go defunct on all your loans and everything else to give. But you can start to manage that. You can hold off on a purchase. I know when we would go to purchase a home, they would say, oh, you qualify for this big of a mortgage. We're just like, how do you get that from our income? Well, the mortgage people don't take into account that you really give 10, well, that we were giving, they don't ask, but that we're giving 10% away. So we have to deduct that from what the mortgage or the car dealer would tell us what we could afford to give. It's like, no, we can't. That means I need to change my desires. I need to lower my expectations. I need to really say, okay, God, help meet my needs, not my desires. And if I still really want that item, that vacation, Lord, help me bring in some extra money to pay for that. How can I get more creative with my income, legally, creative with my income, so that I can have those things that I feel that I need. And I know that is that's just a plan. For some of you, that plan may be, okay, so I will skip my expensive, you can tell I have an issue with expensive coffee. I will skip my $4 cups of coffee. Okay, I can't skip 5 days worth, but I can cut back 3 days. And those 3 days will be $12 times, if you take 4.3, that's how many weeks in a month, you know, really you could be given an extra almost $50 to the kingdom. And so there are just ways that you can think creatively. I would encourage you to think with others who know you, love you, and won't judge you if you are struggling with how in the world am I going to give. So that's, again, folks, that's one way in giving. But still, how do we deal with the person on the street? Let's call it what it is. You know, do I open up my wallet every time somebody approaches me at Stater Brothers? And I don't know what the deal is there, but there sure seems to be a lot of folks asking for handouts at Stater Brothers. That's my observation. Oh, and Costco I've noticed too a little bit. But anyway, so does that mean I just open up my wallet every time and give them whatever is in there or whatever I'm comfortable with? Well, there are plenty of agencies that can help people. And so I'm not saying that you shouldn't, but there may be some other options where you can say, you know what, maybe there's a way you could sit down and talk with them, have a conversation. Maybe you actually buy them a meal versus handing them the money. Whatever way that is going to answer the cry in your heart as to what to do. Even here at the church, you know, some of you give to our benevolence fund. That's a fund that where we help those in need, and we start with those at home right here. But there's also a process, because we just don't give to anybody that comes into the door and gives us a sob story. And boy, some of those are quite interesting stories. Some of them I've heard more than once from the same person who forgot he came here. But we just don't write out checks or give out gift cards to everybody that comes in. But if you're a part of a life group, and I have a life group leader that says, hey, Juno, this family just, you know, something's occurred and they need help. Well, it's a whole lot easier to help knowing there's a relationship there, knowing that you know the backstory. It's much easier and even more gracious, and we can be even more generous when we know what's really going on. But if four or five of you as church leaders keep coming to me and keep saying the same person keeps coming asking for money, then the question is, what else is going on that maybe we need to give other encouragement, other help besides money? Besides, again, we never give money. It's always a check to whatever they owe to. But besides writing that check, what else needs to happen to walk alongside them so they can break this cycle that they are always in need? And I know that's what it is with me. You know, the more I know somebody, the whole lot easier it is for me to open up my wallet. And I can even think as parents, we exercise this gift of mercy with our kids. At least I do. And if I know my daughter is just blowing money and she needs something, I can get pretty tight, pretty quick. And you know, you need to live with your decisions. On the other hand, if she's just been loyal and she is giving to the church, and she is making wise decisions, and something in life hits the fan, and she needs some help, I'll help her. Now, I have my boundaries. I usually, 9 out of 10 times, I don't pay to have nails done. Once in a while, I'll do that as a sucker, I guess. I don't know. But anyway, as a dad. So again, folks, there are organizations that will help help process your gift so that they are also good stewards of what you are giving them. And so, you know, giving happens in different ways. It's not just a dollar. This past month, our rooted groups, you know, over 25 groups had the opportunity to do acts of service, to give something in need to people. They visited the confined. They repaired and painted buildings. They prepared food. They served food. They loved on people. They listened to stories from real old people and stories from our younger people. They got involved to make a difference. And I think we're hitting about 300-ish in our rooted group. So over the last month, 300 little missionaries from New Life were out there being missional and giving to the needy in some way or another. And I think that is just wonderful. I think that is just a huge step for us as a church, but even for you as an individual, because what again happens is you build that relationship. Because so many of us have stereotypes of people who are in need. And the stereotype is because we don't know their story. We don't know them. And so as you get to know them, again, the mysterious work of God happens. And then one more thing is we probably often take for granted is that we offer food to over 150-ish to 200 people every week in our food distribution. And while we've been doing it now for years, it's easy to take that for granted. But that is also a way for us to build relationships, to give a helping hand to those who need. And so do we all have it figured out? You know what? No way. We don't have it all figured out. But the more we're involved in a relationship with others, the more God will do a mysterious work in our heart and open our heart so that we can give to the needy. And that in a way that they will be able to see Jesus through you. Again, Jesus says it is more blessed to give to receive. And for those of us who tithe, for those of you who tithe, I know that's a sacrifice. And so while you're giving, God still, and I don't know how he does it, that God mysteriously works in our hearts to remind us that this money isn't mine. It really all belongs to God to begin with. And so as I practice that giving, something happens in my own heart to make me more merciful to other people. And so as we open our hearts and open our wallets to give, I am confident that as we have seen through our rooted groups this past month, I'm confident that in your own neighborhoods, as you are expressing that gift of mercy, as you are giving to the needy, giving the alms to the needy, I am confident that people will see Jesus in a new way. And I'm even more confident that God will use all of us to continue to create a growing number of communities marked by reconciliation, peace, justice, and hope. And all God's people said, amen. Well, the worship team is coming back out to lead us in our response time. And worship is a time to acknowledge who God is. Worship is a time that we sing. It's a time when we process things, or a time when we hear God's word. But as we respond, you can do so by lighting a candle. Well, the candles are here and in the back. As a reminder, Lord, help me to give. And if your wallet is tighter than tight and those moths need to be set free, you know, ask God to work on you in a way that you can give in a way that honors God and meets a need. You can come up and celebrate communion to be reminded of the sacrifice that God gave to you. And we'll have a roamer that'll come around to also serve. You can go to the cross and you can put a slip of paper on there as a way of to remind you of what you are either giving up for Lent so that you can draw closer to God, or what you are doing during Lent to draw you closer to God. Or over here we'll have some people praying for you by the organ. But also during our giving, right before the offering comes, I want to announce what our Easter offering is going to be. And so in the spirit of Lent and in the spirit of giving to others, we are going to help out Margaret's House in Bellflower. Now again, traditionally for years now, our offering, our Easter offering, is a special offering, meaning it's an addition to your what you give on a Sunday. And so we have needs of the church, of our ministries that will be met, and anything above that, we really hope to be able to bless Margaret's House. Now, those of you who don't know about Margaret's House, it's a transitional family shelter. And if you haven't been in the world of shelters, there's often the males and the females, and never the two shall come together. But the beauty of Margaret's House is that it's a family shelter. And so families can be there together, not in separate locations. And Margaret's House has a huge success rate of helping people to create, find employment and to move into housing and to have a sustainable living. And it's right here in Bellflower. And so we have some brochures, some flyers in the back if you really want to know more in detail about Margaret's House. But over the next few weeks, you'll have opportunities to give. You can grab one of the envelopes in the chairs in front of you that have Easter offering. You can give online and go through the drop-down menu, and it'll say Easter offering. But again, it's not arm-twisting to say, okay, God, what will you have me do this season so that I can be a follower of you and give from my heart? And so let us worship together.